Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today I'm going to explain you how to fine-tune a defined base for document classification. We are going to do the sequence classification in this case with the transformer library, and we will use MRflow to log all the activity and artifacts that we produce during the fine-tuning. We are going to work in a Colab Pro, so we will set up a MRflow server locally. I already explained MRflow in a previous video, so I will not go very deep into MRflow setup, MRflow server, I mean, because again, it's already on the channel. If you have interest, just send me an email and I will point you out to the right video on the channel where I explain all the details and how we interact with NGRK to expose the port where MRflow is running and to internet and be able to access to the MRflow server from your local environment in a configuration that you probably could use as well if you are running something inside your cloud account or in a private network. It's very well known tool as well to test and well develop previews and many other things. For example, I just see here three of the typical use cases for what you use NGRK, which essentially is a tunneling tool. And here again, we use it to just expose to a public IP address on the NGRK facilities the 500 port, 5000 port of MRflow, of the MRflow server, and be able to access to the to the MRflow UI. And today again we will work with a defined model, a base size, and we will use sequence classification loader, which essentially will create or will take only from the defined model the encoder, and it will plug on the top on the encoder a classification head to do a binary or multi-class classification. We need to distinguish in between two different kinds of classification using transformers. One it is sequence classification, the other one is sequence to sequence classification. I'm preparing a second video where I will explain how it works, because there is key differences in how you need to load the model and what is the purpose at the end and what is finally producing the model. In this case, in sequence to sequence, we generate a sequence of tokens, and in the case of the sequence classification, we generate a label, a prediction, a 0, 1, or a number of the label. In this case, we are going to do binary classification, so here we produce the typical output of a classifier, because essentially what we have on the head is a classifier, no? It's how we are with this. We need to distinguish that, because again, depending which class we use to load the model, driving the whole process of setting up the whole process, the whole logic to train, fine-tune the model, and also even the data set, how you prepare it, the data collator, the how you are going to be the computer metrics method, etc., because again, this is different output. We got the same at the end, but the transformer is working differently, and also how we train it is differently, and and how we evaluate it is also different. Well, this guide or this tutorial is working for all these models, and if you follow the what I'm going to show you today, you will be able to load any of these models that you see on this list and use it for sequence classification. In this case, I'm gonna do document classification. Very simple example. My objective is to create a generic classifier which accepts the number of the with that a number which accepts a number of classes, a number of labels, and we receive a data set of the documents correctly labeled, and we train or fine-tune a base model, in this case a T5, but you can use whatever you have in this list following this tutorial, and produce a document classifier, no? Okay, let's move. And then again, we will use MRflow to log all the activity that we generate in this experiment. And let's start. We just connect the drive. We install the libraries we need, and we get Python, get underscore Python. This is getting an interactive shell and executing here an command in the operating system. This is just starting the servers, the MRflow server in the port 500,000, and then on this is the way to execute it with the library IPython. Here we are installing again the necessary libraries. We instantiate ngrok, okay, and we using the token. You need to have an account. You can just set up the account. It's free. You get an online token, a tunnel. Sorry. You can use it one as much as you want, but only you can have one at the same time. You need the token that once you create the account, it generates automatically an authentication token, and this is the token that you need to set up to your ngrok instance, and then on set up a tunnel to redirect everything that go in and out to the port 5000 in local to the infrastructure of the ngrok, and they will expose this into a public IP address, as I will show you later on here, like it's happened here, essentially. You see here we had this IP address. You check here the URI. It's exactly the same what you are producing. So what is doing these sentences here? Is exposing or tunneling? Oh, come on! Tunneling everything that that we have that is served or goes to the port 5000 of the MRflow to this public IP address in the ngrok infrastructure. We load the classes and the libraries that we need. We need to load, in this case, AutoModel for sequence classification, which is a generic library to do sequence classification. We have as well 145, but well, if you want to use whatever is on this list, again, use this library I imported here. AutoModel for sequence classification, and this will create the model just with the encoder, and will create as well on top of that encoder a classification head. If you think how it's done, what it will happen here, you will pass the test through the encoder, and then on it will produce a label, this encoder. So it will produce a vectors of the after the at the end of the attention head, and this will be the input of a classifier, in this case a binary classifier. And the way to do this setup using a conventional TFI model is using this loader. If you by default the TFI is an encoder-decoder architecture like any other transformer, together with some additional layers, with the aim of produce tokens, generate tokens. This is not the way that we are gonna use the TFI. We will do something slightly different, and to do that, we need to use this other class. I will create another video where I explain how we do this, the conventional classification with the sequence to sequence, so token generation, usually works the transformers. But again, this change a lot, or change the way that we prepare the data set and also the logic that we use to evaluate, and well, the trainer during training. And well, it's gonna be very long. I prefer to do it in a separate video. Okay, we essentially import the classes. I had a data frame. Essentially, this data frame just contains two columns. One is labor, the other one is text. This is the extraction of some of documents. I had two classes here, CV and non-CV. So the data sets are completely balanced. I had many documents. I'm just doing, again, a custom generic classifier. I'm doing some tests to evaluate how many documents I need per class in order to decide what is at the end the minimum number of documents I need to create a good classifier. In this case, again, I choose two data sets. One is the data, which is going to be used for training, contains 200 samples, 100 CVs, 100 non-CV. Inside the non-CV, there is also other human resources documents, but not CVs. For example, job descriptions, but not CVs. And together with other documents from legal department, commercial department, and some others. And CVs are pure CVs from people. It's not relevant that. And in the data test is the holdout data set, as well as containing 50-50 of CVs and non-CVs, document that is not included on the training data set. Here we prepare a dictionary to map the labels. In this case, we have CV and non-CV, 1 and 0. So in the data frame, we have it, probably we can have here data, data paths, data set. Well, exactly. I need to essentially map this again. Let's do it. And then you see the data head, you have CV. Then we pass this, and now we just map the CV, the string to a number to do categorization, the categories, and not use the strings, because essentially we cannot use it. As you probably know, you for sure know that in the classifier we need to use integers as labels, and not not string, so we need to do encoding, one hot encoding of the strings that we have in our label label column. So then we create a dataset, a Hugging Face dataset with the class dataset, dataset from Panda data, data test, and the training data, we split it in between train and test. The test dataset of the train dataset is going to be used for validation during training. So essentially for training we have 160 documents, 80. I hope so we can do this slightly better, probably to just divide the documents stratified, because we are not really sure that we here finally had the same number of the documents in CV, non-CV in dataset, but okay, doesn't really matter. I will improve this So here the idea is to have to divide as well the training dataset in between train and test for training, and keep the same relation of the CV, non-CV of labels in the two sets. But this is just an improvement I need to do. Well, at the end, 160 for training, 40 for validation on during training, and you have an example here of what this look like. So it is the text. Now we load the tokenizer with the convention. It doesn't matter, here is auto tokenizer. You just create the tokenizer with the maximum length of the context window or the DeFi base, which is 512. We tokenize the dataset. So we create a function here and we create a simply token. We tokenize the dataset. Later we create two dictionaries to map the the labels strings and reverse, and we load the model with the model name, which is the DeFi base, number of labels 2, and the label to ID and ID to label dictionaries. Let's create it again. We create a data collator here. You need to create a data collator with padding. Not use the data collector for sequence to sequence, because this is what we will use in that one. We just create here a placeholder, and here we have the function to evaluate metrics. So every time that you enter into evaluation model, every epoch, as we have defined later on in the setup, model safe strategy epochs and evaluation strategy epochs. At the end of the epochs, we will get here an object. The object is type evaluation prediction. We receive an object which contains essentially the predictions, labels, and inputs. In this object, the model is going to generate a tuple with these three components. And you need to consider that because some of the trainers, depending which loader, model loader you use, this tuple contains predictions and labels, or predictions and label, or prediction labels and inputs. So to To check that and to make it this a little bit more general, so we take a val preds, which is the object that we are receiving after the at the end of the epoch. We load the metrics, and if you receive two, we receive logits and labels, and if you receive three, so meaning that the logit is a tuple. So what we do is we take the position zero of this tuple and then we assign it to logit. Later on, we generate the predictions and we compute the metrics as usual. Here, notice that we are calculating these four metrics for every epoch. So we are returning a dictionary of metrics here. So this will cause that if you want to generate or create or attach a callback to stop the training when if one of the metrics or the metrics that you choose here, like eval loss, is not progressing, is not improving, stop it. Doing that way with when you return all these metrics, it's not possible to do it that way. You need to generate a custom callback, and in this case I didn't do it, so this is not gonna work even that is configured. So we create our training arguments. Again, this is changing. Is the one that you need to use for sequence to sequence classification. If you use sequence to sequence, you need to use sequence to sequence training arguments object. And then on here we create the trainer. So the trainer has our model, our training arguments, token, train dataset, test dataset. This is the 160. This is 40. This is 160. Exactly. And we have here our data collator and the metrics. That is the function we define above. We set up the tracking URI. This is pointing to our local MLflow server in the local host IP address in the port 5000. We set up the name of the experiment, as it's already created. Not gonna create anything more here. Every time that you set the name of the experiment, it is not on the list. It creates a new one, and how it's organized, you set up the experiments, and inside the experiment you have runs. Every run is a different experiment, and you localize your experiment using run ID. Also, the experiment has a experiment ID. You can go here to the your file system if you want to see how it works. You go to the ML server, the MLflow server, in which you create these two carpet folders. One is ActiveFast and the other one is Run. In this setup, we are not using a database as backend. We are using the file system, and then everything is going to be saved on the file system. And then the metadata will be saved in different JSON files. And the artifacts, meaning that the tables, something that you plot and log to MLflow models, everything is inside this folder. So the folder is organized in the first level. So the root level is ML artifacts. The second level is the ID of the experiment. And the next level is the run ID. I will show you later how to localize everything in this in the file system. So we start the trainer, and essentially, well, it's gonna take kind of 5 minutes. So I will stop. Once it's done, I will return and continue with the explanation of this tutorial. Okay, that's done. So first of all, once the training is progressing, every epoch we evaluate and produce the metrics. When you run at your in your environment, you will see something different. As here, there is two small problems. One is the data set is not currently split. And also, I didn't restart the session after the previous video. I recorded before, and then, but you will see. It's just an example of how it works, no? And then this is produced by the during training. You see here you have your training logs, validation of set one rock AUC, recall and precision is what we define here in the computer metrics. Later we save the training to the local directory. To the local host, we are saying in the model, the training model shape pre-trainer custom path is that one here, and also the data collator tokenizer, we also save it to the custom path. Everything is there, and then on we create a dictionary with the key model, the model itself, and the tokenizer. The tokenizer is here. If you set up here load the best mode at the end, you don't need to do anything. The best model is what is pointing in these two objects. Then we lock the model with the class transformers inside from Emberflow. I mentioned it in the video where I explained how Emberflow works. Emberflow is fully integrated with most of the deep learning and LLMs or machine learning frameworks like Scikit-learn, PyTorch, Phase AI, or TensorFlow. Or transformers. This means that there is different flavors that or different classes which manage the interaction with these different frameworks from Emberflow. And then what they do is just create a generic or standard way to or unified way to log and access models using Emberflow, regardless which technology you are using under the hood. In this case it's Emberflow, but if you want to use a PyTorch model, you just need to use Emberflow PyTorch block model, and the object change is slightly different, but you will see that what they produce here on the as outcome on artifacts is gonna be the same. So well, not gonna be the same, but you will say the main components, the main files to later deploy this model into another environment is a standard across the different frameworks that you may use. No, the only thing that you need to use is the correct class in Emberflow, and this way you prepare it in such way that you log it to the Emberflow server. In this case, it's to the lake. You can see here Ember artifacts. So the Emberflow run ID is the 6DD ending in D733. So that one. So in artifacts, you had test classifier. You can enter and you see the files. You can see the same exactly here in the UI. This is because on the Emberflow, what is logging to the tables is the metadata. The metadata, and this metadata contain pointers to the location of the any relevant file on the that you log or metric or whatever you are logging to Emberflow. This way, you can access the model with any model that you log with Emberflow in a using the same methods, and those methods, as they are derived from different classes, you just need to adapt either the log model or the set or the load model according to the class that you are using. In this case, as we are using Transformer, we are going to log a pipeline type text classification, and what we log is this dictionary which contain the model and tokenizer. If you are, for example, logging a TensorFlow model, the parameters here may change, but you will have for sure a Emberflow TensorFlow log model. Or in XGBoost, you can do the same log model with other parameters, and it will finally serialize a number of files together with the requirements txt, Python environment, YAML. Sorry, let me show you here. Sorry, in the artifact, you see here the Conda YAML, everything that you need to set up a Conda environment. This is essentially taken from your environment in this local computer where you are executing the client, and the assumption is if it is working here, it's gonna work in another place the same, no? So here you have the model cars, everything that so depending on the flavor you use to serialize the model. The class in this case, flavor in this case is class, it will log different files, but the main ones to replicate, to recreate the environment is going to be the same. So this is going to be regardless the model requirements. If you have, for example, XGBoost, you for sure will not see accelerators or Torch Vision or Transformers. You will see XGBoost and Pickle, I suppose, as well, and Emberflow. So it's providing you with all that you may need to deploy this model into a different container or a different server. Let's move. So the object run here, sorry, I didn't explain that, but here with the Emberflow start run, we are creating a client, Emberflow client. The name is run, and this run is going to capture all the relevant information of this run. So you can see here, you can explore the run object. Oops, sorry. And well, you can transform it to dictionary, for example. Ah, well, it's what you see here, sorry. Ah, well, exactly. And you see everything that is relevant, and this will allow you to localize what you this experiment into the Emberflow server. The most relevant, the most important, again, is the experiment ID. Okay. In some cases, well, you can get from here also the, you can infer from here the where the the relevant artifacts are in the hard disk. You can see here the experiment ID, that one, and the run ID, that one. So I didn't execute that exactly. So experiment ID, run ID 73, that one, and then on artifacts, and then on inside artifacts you have an artifact path. This artifact path parameter is common across all the classes in Everflow in the method log model. So in this case, as we are logging a pipeline, a transformers pipeline, we need to specify attacks. But in case that you are logging again, I don't know, HGBoost, this will not, you will not have tags, but for sure you will have an artifact path. Here the run data, so another, well, this is only the data key in the object run. So now we take the model info URI, which is what it's returned from MLflow transformer log model. After logging the model, you receive this model info object. You can check it out here as well. Model info is another dictionary. Oh, sorry. I think we need to transform to dictionary. Metadata artifact part. Okay, you can check all the attributes of this object and just take the URI at the end is the path in the in this experiment where the model was locked. And using the load model, you see here the same model, MLflow transformer, and now load model, you now get the model from using the URI, URI, okay, and what it returns components. Again, these two models, methods, load model and log model and load model, where is where I am, sorry, you have it in all ML deep learning frameworks that that they are integrated with MLflow. They may change what the return type, but for sure what you had as well in this case in the load model is the URI where is saved the artifacts, the files in the hard disk. And all this metadata also you can find it in here in ML runes. You also can go here. And you have the meta YAML. And you have artifacts, metrics, parameter, tags. Everything that you see here on the description, everything that you see here on the UI is here serialized here on the disks. The history, everything, params, metrics, everything. Here, this is something that I recommend you to watch the video where I explain how MLflow works. Here we are using as backend for logging data and metadata in MLflow the file system, but you can also log the metadata only to a database. Usually it's done to a database, an SQL database, and it can be Postgres, it can be Microsoft SQL, it can be whatever, Oracle as well. So far is you had a connection link to that, and you had access, read write access. You can log all this metadata in tables in that database. The connection, the URI connection change, so here when we specify this is everything done to the file system, but changing this URI in the documentation, you can take a look and also in the video I uploaded before regarding this topic. Changing the URI, you will have access to different technologies to keep the metadata. The data is always saved in the file system, it's not saved inside the database. And the only that is safe on the tables on the database, case that you are using a database as backend, is the pointers to the files, to the folders where you save the artifacts. Artifacts again can be tables, models, plots, whatever you want to serialize to MLflow. Okay, we load here the model with the method load model, and you see here that we are returning the components, and the components you have the tokenizer and you have the model. This and take it again, and now we are going to create a function to load or to create our dataset from the holdout dataset. It's containing 284 files that never seen or during training process, containing label and Justin blah blah blah. Whatever, just CV, what I see. I think we don't need it. I know we need the classification report, and then on now we create the pipeline, transformers pipeline. You can see here essentially is you are calling to the method pipeline from transformer, and you pass the components, which are the model and the tokenizer. And then you just execute the tokenizer with a text, and you have it here. As you see, this is a conventional classifier where you have a label and a score. Here I create a method to evaluate the model, and essentially we are taking the predictions, the labels, and the score, creating different lists. And here we print the classification report. Then you take the model. Here you see it's claiming because some of the files are very big, bigger than 512 tokens. That is the maximum context window of this model, the one that we use for the tokenizer. And you see here we got, not bad, it's pretty, I think we can get one in all the metrics just if we balance the data frame correctly, the training data frame. Because this, I think we can get it. In the next video, when I will describe how to do sequence to sequence, we will do it that way. And you will see how we get one everything. We now print a confusion matrix, and well, as well, not bad. So we only fail in for non-CV. CV classifier is correctly classified. Okay. Probably here, as I mentioned you, in the non-CV dataset, we have some documents that are job descriptions. It may fail some of them. We can take a look to which ones are bad classifier in this class and review essentially which kind of documents they are. But I can imagine that they are job descriptions because they are part of the non-CV dataset class. Okay, that's all. I hope you like it. I think it's very interesting stuff. How to do a fine tuning with MLflow. I'm gonna be recording more videos about MLflow. I'm involved in a project. I need to create a custom classifier with a number or arbitrary number of classes defined by the user. And then on the only thing that the user needs to pass me is the pointer to a position, a location in the data lake. And with that, I will read this folder. The documents have to be correctly labeled in different folders. And with that, create a classifier. Either with the sequence classification or with sequence to sequence. I still deciding what to do, and also deciding what is the minimum number of documents I need to get a good classifier. This is not bad, but I think we can create ones that performs 100% correct. Here we are just failing in some documents, and this is part of a bigger project which again, we will provide the user the ability to create custom document classifiers and only tuning LLMs or LLMs, small LLMs in the class that we are you saw at about this notebook, and then we will allow the user to create their own classifiers and classify the documentation that they have on the data lake. That's all. Thank you very much for watching. I hope you like it and you find it interesting and informative. And if you like it, just give me a like and subscribe to the channel if you didn't do it before. And also share with your friends and colleagues if you think this is also interesting for them. Thank you very much. See you soon.